We're live on the 5 a.m. Master Scrum Show. A little bit later because I had to do a coaching session earlier about 7:30 this morning. So we started the show a little bit late, but it was a good coaching session. It was great. I'm going to share a little bit from that and turn off the sound and show my bright and shiny face. And Bubbles. Bubbles, come here before you get all comfy.
Oh, there she is. Hi, everyone out there. I'm Bubbles.
Anyway, that's Bubbles the cat. She loves it when I do this show. She comes over here and finds me. Anyway, 5 a.m. Master Scrum Show. I hope you're doing well. And this morning, I want to talk about the Agile Manifesto a little bit because there's always people out there talking about you work on one side and not on the other one, and we always should be on the left and never on the right. And I want to disagree with some of those people and kind of share why you need to do a little bit of both and be balanced, right? So I had to work out today, so I walked the dog early in the morning. It's cold. It's changed. So that's why I'm wearing the sweatshirt. Anyway, 5 a.m. Master Scrum Show. We're going to talk about the Agile Manifesto a little bit and why it's good to work on both sides and why both sides are needed. And my philosophy is the left side helps enhance and make things better. And the right side is basically the nature of the beast. So we'll talk about that a little bit. And 5 a.m. Master Scrum Show. I am Greg Master, Scrum Master and Agile Coach. And here we talk about Scrum and Agile in a very practical and tactical way so you can deliver value to a customer. Hey, how you doing? Tululu, hey, good morning. We got a visitor here from Edinburgh, right? Edinburgh. So one of the things we talk about is how we apply this in the thought process. When I coach people, I always get them to think of the heart and soul behind Scrum and Agile, and they both have their different places. You can go by the Scrum Guide, you can go for the manifesto, but you want to do both together, by the way, both sides to get where you want to be. So in the manifesto, there's a left side and a right side. They always say about individuals and interactions over tools and processes, right? That's one left side thing. And then they also value working software, which I really think should be working product, by the way, over comprehensive documentation. Now, that doesn't say documentation, it's comprehensive documentation. Customer collaboration over contract negotiation and respond to the change over plan. So let's think about that a little bit. Their first one, individuals' interactions over tools. So would it be better to have a face-to-face interaction or send an email? Which one's more productive? Depends. But the more highly interaction, if you want to work together with someone, would be a face-to-face communication. So the more times you can do that, the more productive that interaction will be. Sometimes emails, Jira, Azure, some system where you communicate, especially if you have teams across the world, are necessary, right? You need that tool to help communicate. Maybe you're sick. Maybe you're remote. Maybe you're taking care of your kids, take care of a pet, whatever, or parent or something, and that you just can't be there. You need that tool to convey some information. So it's a necessity. It's a nature of the beast to have it. Ideally, it would be interaction and personal, but sometimes we can't do that. And sometimes these corporations and companies don't create that environment to get there. Now, if you have your own company and you can create the environment, so be it. You know, here in the States, do you buy stuff from China? Do you think you can have a visual interaction with the people from China? Probably not. So you need email. Amazon. I mean, people buy stuff on Amazon. You're not interacting with the brick and mortar store, are you? So come on, let's be realistic here. That stuff exists. So you have to have both. You want to have a good tool, but you also want to really spur the interaction with your team. And we can do other things. I kind of wish I recorded the coaching session I had today. It was really good. It was a non-software related conversation. And working software, working product over comprehensive documentation. Of course you want a working product because you're not going to make any money. Let's be realistic. If you don't have working software and it's in the hands of the customer, you don't make any money. And that's part of the thing, right? So you have to have that. And that's more important the necessary documentation. You could document the heck out of something, but if the customer never uses it because you're still trying to figure out the documentation, one, your product's too complicated and no one understand it and you'll never sell, you know. So this is the kind of thing. I mean, what you're going to sell it to is probably the government. And even then, they're hire 18-year-old kids. What are they going to do? You think they're going to read the documentation? Hell no. I learned that a long time ago. We made all this documentation. The kids are 18, you know, in the military and stuff like that. They're not going to read it, right? But you need comprehensive documentation. What if you had regulations? Of course, the government likes regulations. Some people have to understand the documentation, read it, and confirm they read it for compliance issues, right? So it's there. It's a nature of the beast. It's included. Customer collaboration over contract negotiation. You want that collaboration. You want that feedback loop. That's what the sprint reviews are about. That's what the sprint planning is about, getting the customer in there, help plan, get some of that collaboration, what you all want to work on, what makes sense. And the reviews is that feedback, right? So the more feedback you get from a customer, the better your product is. And also, the more you collaborate, because we say estimates suck, which they do. And they're just good for the short-term thinking to get you moving and where you want to go. Because without that, everyone just stumbles. But by collaborating, you can get a feel for how much time it's going to take and get that feedback loop. Say, well, we can give this. Is this okay? Let's get that to you, at least for now, as we work out these longer, harder issues, more complicated for things we've never done before, right? So that's that collaboration. But contract negotiation. I am never going to advise any company, any person who gets into agreement not to have some kind of agreement. You want to cover your backside, whether it be an employee agreement that you have that you get paid and when you get paid, a contract like between you and a customer. Now there's a lot of legal documents that are super long that no one to read. That's out there. Good morning. Divine Love's on here from Texas. So we had Edinburgh, and we have Texas, right? It's like a pretty broad group here. But you need that contract. You do need a contract sometimes to make sure you're safe, right? So part of that is that need, because you also want to negotiate a little bit that your client doesn't keep asking for stuff without paying you money, right? So I don't think it's right for a customer to keep changing the things without giving you some form of agreement. Maybe at some point you just got to decide you're not going to work with the customer anymore and you need a way of breaking loose on that agreement, because if they keep moving the goalposts and you're never going to get it, you need that contract there a little bit to protect you so you can't ignore it, but you're better off with the customer collaboration. So when things do go awry, how do you figure that out? And maybe that's part of the negotiation. How do you negotiate that collaboration? What is it? Instead of like the requirement, how is the customer collaboration going to look like between you and the client, right? So maybe you need the negotiation, that interaction. And maybe you need the contract negotiation to cover everything in the manifesto. Maybe that's what you need to cover. And not so much how to do it and what and exactly need to be done. And then the last one, responding to change or following plan. Yeah, you need change because stuff happens. We had a big cold, big sickness that came and hit everything. So the whole world changed, right? So we need to respond to that pretty rapidly or you weren't going to make any money. But we also, like in Scrum, have a plan, at least for a leak. But it's a plan for like a sprint, 2 weeks, something like that. It's not a plan for 5 years because no one's going to understand what the hell we're going to do in 5 years. And most of the people in the organization ain't going to be there when you start your 5-year, 2-year plan and going to be there in 5 years. To be honest with you, they're going to move on to another job in the organization or something else. So all these people that want to do this long-term planning, you're probably not even going to be there. You know, they plan, like you look at Congress, look at these politicians. Oh, we're going to change your budget when I'm gone, right? After the election, right? After the change. We'll implement it afterwards, so I'm not held accountable for what I do. Yeah, it's the part of the thing. It's part of the beast. But at least in Agile and Scrum, we have small little plans that are manageable and doable, and we can be held accountable for those plans. Those 5-year, 2-year plans, six, even 6-month plans, I don't know if you can hold anybody accountable to that because stuff changes. So why do you do it? You don't. You just work on being able to respond to change and make your planning smaller. But we do plan. It's important. So I just want to kind of go over that a little bit because so many people are just like anti everything on the right-hand side. But some things on those right-hand sides are needed, like documentation or tools. You need a timesheet, right? Or you don't get paid, right? Or you need to put time in or say, I was here. Give me, you know, pay me my money or whatever like that. Without that tool, how do you ensure you got paid? Hey, I put a timesheet in, so you should pay me. You know, and this kind of things like that. Those are part of it. But everything on the left-hand side, you do really good at that. Your product line will go up higher and you produce more, make more money in the long term, and everything would be much better. So that's why we work on a lot. But you can't neglect the stuff on the right-hand side. What do you do with, like, documentation? You got new hires that never seen anything you knew. You want some documentation for them to understand what you're doing, right? So with that, that's the show for today. It's a Monday. I just want to talk about that just to get you pumped up about all the things out there to learn and everything. And I want to say, think about working product, not just working software, but working product. So how Scrum and Agile can apply to everything you're doing, a product, an output, something that is actually working in the hands of a customer or someone that you work with. With that, I say, have a great day. It's getting cold out there, a little chilly. Got a little chilly last night and walking the dog this morning. It was cold out. So all the best and have a great day. Happy scrumming. Take care.